Private endpoints, not to be confused with service endpoints or the private link service, but private endpoint is the core service behind private links. Confused?
Yeah.
Private endpoints are often mentioned alongside expressions like control network flow and security, but it also has other advantages that I'll go into later on. But first, if we should summarize private endpoints as simply as possible, how should we do it? Well, first, let me just keep you on here on the hook for 30 seconds because of, you know, YouTube algorithms. Kidding, but do like and subscribe. If I were to explain private endpoints in the simplest of terms, it would be this. Private endpoints are network interfaces for your PaaS services. And by PaaS services, I mean services like storage accounts, static web apps, app services, automation accounts, key vaults, and so on. Hey, even Azure Migrate and Azure Arc has support for private endpoints. So let's take a close look at this service, shall we? Microsoft has actually done a pretty good job of confusing people on the naming around private endpoints because it's part of private link and it's used in the private link service, but it isn't private link service. With private link, you can access Azure PaaS services over a private endpoint. With the private link service, you can build your own hosted service in Azure and then have your customers connected privately from their own vnets. But unless you're actually building those kinds of solutions, then the private link service is most likely something you'll never have to worry about. So let's just forget that private link service even exists and focus on private endpoint. Like I said in the intro, private endpoints are basically just network interfaces for your PaaS services. That network interface is then connected to one of your vnets, and from there it gets its own private IP address. That enables you to connect to PaaS services privately, as opposed to across public internet. That in turn naturally increases the security of the connection, since the traffic never leaves Microsoft's backbone. And since the traffic never traverses public internet, you have a lot more control of it. Not total control though, we'll get into that when we discuss limitations. Since your PaaS service is now directly connected to your vnet, you can use features like network security groups to control what traffic is allowed or not, and you can use user-defined routes to route the traffic as you please. So say you have an internal website that is only to be accessed from your internal network. You already have a connection from your on-prem network where your users are located and to Azure. But you can't host that website on an app service, right? Because that would expose it publicly. Nope. You just jam a private endpoint right in there and bam, your users can connect to that private endpoint's private IP and you route that traffic across your ExpressRoute or VPN. But if you've been configuring vnets and subnets in Azure before, you might have noticed something called service endpoints. So how does private endpoints differ from service endpoints? Well, service endpoints only provide an optimized route to whatever PaaS service it's for. The connection from the vnet is still made to that PaaS service's public IP, it just takes a bit of a shortcut. And speaking of shortcuts, that's another major advantage of private endpoints, because whenever you connect to a PaaS service publicly, that traffic goes out on the internet, right? So let's consider this scenario. You want to use Azure Virtual Desktop, and naturally you would then want to use FS Logix to store user profiles on Azure files, right? So you set up a vnet and a storage account and do all the configuration needed to use that storage account as a file share for profiles. You then deploy session hosts or VMs that then connects to that file share for profile download and uploads. The connection is then going out from the vnet to the internet and then back into the storage account. But if you set up private endpoint for that storage account connected to the same vnet as your VMs, then the traffic never leaves the vnet. That not only betters the security, but it's also a whole lot faster and more stable. Another thing that often accompanies talk around private endpoint is DNS, and that's often accompanied by easy to understand diagrams like this one. The reason DNS is important when working with private endpoints is that, unlike a VM, the private endpoints can't automatically register their name and the IP address in DNS. And you don't want to hard code IP addresses anyway or instruct your users to go around remembering IP addresses, so you use DNS. You could, of course, just manually register the IP of the private endpoint in your own DNS solution manually, but the thing is that you're usually not guaranteed that the IP will always be the same. That's why you would typically integrate the private endpoint with a private DNS zone. The integration would then update DNS if the IP changes. The downside of this kind of setup is resolving the DNS record from anything not connected to a vnet linked with that private DNS zone. And that's where you would need either a VM to function as a DNS relay of sorts, or to use the Azure DNS private resolver. Okay, all fun and games up until now. Let's discuss the pricing. Private endpoints start out at a penny per hour and a penny per gigabyte in traffic. Guess that wasn't so hard after all. All right, limitations then. There's not a whole lot, actually. The main thing is that up until a month ago or so, the support for NSGs and UDRs were only in public preview, but they are in GA now, although with some limitations to them. The complete list is on the docs page, which is listed down in the description, but my key takeaways from it is as follows. You can't use the effective routes or effective security rules feature for private endpoints in the Azure portal, so visibility into routes and NSG rules is a bit of a hassle. You can't use NSG flow logs for traffic inbound to a private endpoint. Dual port NSG rules are not supported, so you would need to make more and more specific rules than compared to working with only VMs. Support for NSGs, UDRs, and application security groups are not enabled by default, and you need to enable it per subnet. Another thing that I would mention as a limitation is that usually when creating private endpoints from the PaaS service side, you cannot specify to use a static IP. But if you choose to create the private endpoint manually, you can. So even if it's easier to create the private endpoints from the PaaS service side of things, it's better to not. Earlier on in this video, I mentioned Azure Virtual Desktop, and if you want to know more about the setup process there, check out this video here. Hit that like button if this video proved to be worthy of your time. And yeah, cheers.